wanted to begin by first giving some thanks to Doug and to Kathy. This has been a long wait to gather, and I wanted to appreciate the grace under pressure that both of you have demonstrated over and over to me as we've gotten our hopes up and then had to cancel and hopes up and cancel. So I just wanted to particularly point that out, how much I've appreciated being with you in this time of sadness and release. So let's begin the act of prayer. Each of our lives, O God, has meaning and purpose. You created us in your image to do good in the world, and you value us as partners in the care of each other and of all creation. You accept our time and talent and treasure for a purpose greater than our own lives, and we gather this day to celebrate the life of a larger-than-life partner who, using his own time and talent and treasure, enriched the world and did great good. We gather to honor that man, to give thanks to you, O God, and to remember the greater calling that is asked of each of our lives. And we also gather to grieve, as we've been grieving. We gather because we have sorrow. We sorrow this day that everyone can't be physically with us. The whole family can't be here. The family of friendships can't be here. We grieve also that this day reminds us that we can't have just one more conversation, just one more day with this remarkable man. So come, Holy Spirit, comfort our sorrows. Enrich the gratitude that we have in our hearts and the assurance of joy in which each of us are connected, knowing that even death itself is just one more step on a longer journey, and like Jesus, we will rise, and until that day, we live in faith.
Troubles come and my heart reddened grieve. I'll start by saying thank you to the whole Paauw family for giving me the honor of sharing my thoughts as we celebrate the life of Doug Paauw Sr., for it was a life well lived. My first memories of Doug Paauw Sr. were his stalwart and loving support of his wife, Kay, who was my patient for many years. In early years, he had a ponytail, and they would go on cruises together. Over the years, he would attend many of her appointments, listening quietly. But each visit, he would share 30 seconds of the details of her life and functioning at home that brought clarity and improved my ability to care for Kay. Even if their perspectives were different, his words were always framed with caring. In that slow cadence, clear, low register, no conflict would arise between them. Their relationship of mutual love and caring was remarkable and moving. I learned from them that to live a good married life, you show up, you listen, and speak the truth, but do it with kindness. 2014 was the hardest of years. Doug and the family lost Kay and their son Scott. The Paauw family rallied around Doug Sr., even in their mutual pain. Doug Jr. and Kathy were never more than 5 minutes away. Carly and Cindy would check on their granddad all the time, and Alan lived with Doug Sr. making culinary delights I would get to hear about at our appointments. Lori, his caregiver, was ever present, and they had a great relationship with mutual affection, and she could tease him in little ways I never could. When I was trying to understand how often he really used his walker, Doug was politely being vague, and Lori chimed in, doesn't want to use his walker because of the way it looks. The lessons I learned from Doug is to live a good life, you have to surround yourself with people who love you. I got to know Doug more when he became my patient 5 years ago. Doug had health challenges, but he always saw himself as healthy. He was committed to exercise his whole life. He loved tennis, and I got to hear about my name twin, Genevieve, his tennis partner, and their tennis exploits together. When his hip told him that tennis was no longer an option, he took to a stationary bike with more dedication. Even in his last year, he became a bit of a celebrity at his physical therapy office. They adored Doug and wanted to extend his physical therapy prescription indefinitely, his tenacity for returning to his best function. And an unwavering optimism has so much to do with how he lived so well for 98 years. Doug Paauw Sr.'s life changed this world in ways I don't fully understand. His contributions to academia and the field of economics are great. His impact on the economic development of Indonesia and my home country of the Philippines were foundational. His years as a dedicated professor left their mark on his students, but I'm not the best person to speak to all these achievements. The legacy I got to see up close was one of a truly good, kind, graceful, and honorable man. He stood up for what was right, and he believed in democracy and its ability to help all the people in this world, especially those most in need. He and Kay raised their sons to value education and to love learning. Scott was talented and a beloved linguistics professor, and Doug Sr., my mentor since medical school, has been an exceptional and inspiring teacher to a generation of medical students. Doug Sr. loved his family. Nothing lit up his bright blue eyes more than to talk about his grandkids, Alan, Cindy, and Carly, and in the last few years, his great-grandkids. I know we got a couple of precious bonus years with Doug because he knew Rory and Violet were on their way. I am so thankful he had the joy of holding them both. I miss you and I love you, Doug. I trust in God that you and Kay and Scott are reunited. Thank you for the lessons you taught me and for leaving behind such a fine family, your greatest legacy. So I was gonna prepare something in the midst of preparing something and writing. I was going through some items and I found this. This is my fifth grade biography project that I chose to do of my grandfather, Douglas Seymour Paauw. So I figured I'd give you all a recap of his life through a fifth grade lens. All of it, which still applies now. It's just me, my voice 20 years ago. So my grand, and I'm gonna add a little bit more, you know, and take away some things. feel free to look at it afterwards to see what I did edit out. But my grandfather, Douglas Seymour Paauw, was born on December 13th, 1921. Which, December 13th, also my birthday, and he always called me his birthday girl. It was a special day that we shared together. When he was in his childhood, he had happy times and sad times. When he was 25, I don't think that's accurate, I think it's 27, he married my grandmother, Helen Kathleen Horan. I had a little side note of how they met here, so I'm gonna read that. My grandmother and my grandfather first fell in love when they were on a double date. My grandmother went out with another guy, and my grandfather went out with this other lady. After the date, my grandfather wanted to steal my grandmother from this guy, so he offered them a ride home. First, he dropped my grandma's guy off. While my grandfather was taking my grandmother home, they fell in love. 3 weeks later, they got engaged. And 5 months later, they married. After 2 years, my grandparents... No, that was not accurate. Their first child was my father, Scott. After 2 years, they gave birth to another baby boy. They named him after my grandfather, Doug. He traveled to a lot of places. At university, he studied economics. He started teaching at Harvard and at other universities around the world. He had a happy life when he was young, especially with his family. This is 20 years ago again. Now he's 78 years old. He's my favorite grandfather, mind you, my only one. I call him Granddaddy. He only has 3 grandchildren. When we're there, he really likes playing tennis. He's pretty good at it too. When we're there, he takes my brother, my cousin, my grandma, and I biking. He says the most happiest times of his life is when the whole family gets together. When the whole family gets together, he's really happy. He also has had some sad times and hard times in his life. Though his greatest achievements are his children and family. I really love my grandfather. Growing up, my grandfather was an integral part of my life. I feel incredibly fortunate to have lived just a few minutes away from him, sharing countless weekends, summer days, Sunday night dinners, and bike trips with him and my grandmother. Something that comes to mind when I envision my granddad is a phrase he would often say to me in my childhood. I used to be afraid of the dark when I would sleep over at my grandparents' house. When I would come to him crying about how scared I was, Granddad would grab a flashlight as he followed me and would say to me in a confident yet playful voice, "Never fear, Granddaddy's here."
Instead of just turning on the lights and telling me everything was safe, he would shine the flashlight into all the dark corners to show me that there was nothing to be afraid of hidden there. Even then, as I was just beginning to grasp the world and my place in it, he wanted to teach me not to fear the unknown, but to seek it out and understand it so it wasn't so scary. Long after I had moved on from that phase, Granddad continued to provide a sense of wholeness and stability in my life that has served as a pillar of support in the times I needed it most. In times where I'm feeling anxious or in need of strength, that phrase still surfaces, echoing in my head and leaving me with a sense of calm. When I think of my grandfather, I think of strength, kindness, worldliness, stubbornness, resilience, and an overwhelming sense of family. Granddad was the rock of our family. His lived experiences have passed down through generations and have tied us all together in ways that cannot be measured in words. His heart was the binding force in our family, and his legacy will live on in the stories and memories we hold close in our hearts. I'm going to end with this beautiful poem that touches on the impact that Granddad has had on our family. Our grandfather kept a garden of the heart. He planted all the good things that gave our lives their start. He turned us to the sunshine and encouraged us to dream, fostering and nurturing the seeds of self-esteem. And then the winds and rain came. He protected us enough, but not too much, because he knew we would stand up strong and tough. His constant good example always taught us right from wrong, markers for our pathway that will last a lifetime long. We are our grandfather's garden. We are his legacy. Thank you, Granddad. We love you.
Hey there. As you can see, I'm not as prepared as my cousin, my sister there, but I just want to say a few words here. My grandfather being born at the eve of the Great Depression, that's one of his favorite subjects to talk to about everybody over and over again. Growing up with him when he was living in Indonesia for many years and also here in Seattle, he would love to have his family was everything to him. And he would constantly talk about how his life was growing up in the 40s and 50s. And his stories about meeting my grandmother, and as Cindy mentioned, just falling in love with her, how everything happened in, within 6 months. He said that it was the most important thing to him. And when he had his first two children, first my dad, and then my uncle, he said that was a true gift to him. And then later on when I came along, being the first of his three grandchildren, he was very, very happy to live in Indonesia during that time with my grandmother. He showed me around, taught me the ropes, especially when my parents were very busy at work. Cindy and I would spend our weekends over there with them. And I learned a lot, and also visiting them over here in Seattle throughout the 90s. We had many trips together. They were very, very memorable. But as we grew older, we learned some of the fun things around my grandfather too. How any television set he had, he would, first thing he'd always know is where the mute button was. He was obsessed with muting ads on TV, and even sometimes news that's not important to him when there's house guests over there trying to listen, and he's like, oh, I don't care. He's like, that's not my thing. So he loved that whenever we had our dinners together. I think probably every 2 or 3 days, we'd always have to buy a new bottle of ranch for him. He'd fly through ranch dressing. So anyway, yeah, we had a great time just spending time with him, and then we knew that his time wasn't going to be around much longer. But I do have to say a special thank you to his physician, Genevieve, who prolonged his life, and that was very important to all of us. And, you know, the Paauw family is like saying thank you endlessly to that. That means a lot to us, and he'll always be in our hearts forever. Thank you.
So, my name is, I'm the other Genevieve. And I do want to thank you as well for inviting me to be here. It's such an honor to be with the family. It's truly an honor. So Doug and I met, I think more than 15 years ago, at Robinswood Tennis Center. He was on the court with two of his three other buddies, and the third buddy didn't show up. So somebody asked me in the office if I would fill in and be their fourth. And from that point forward, I was the fourth. And I truly loved playing tennis with Doug and his gang. And we would spend a lot of times after we'd play tennis, and they would chit-chat about the various aspects of their lives, their time in the service, and I just was all ears. It was just an amazing group. And but of course, Doug was my favorite. And even after his tennis days were through, we continued to meet and become even greater friends. But I want to mention I had the great pleasure of also playing doubles with Cindy. When she was visiting, he made a point of saying, you know, we have to play with my granddaughter. So so that was really a treat. But we would visit in the house, he and Kay, and we would have long talks, go on an outing. We took Kay to the Bellevue Arts Museum, where she had such an impact for many years, and that was a really great day. We'd also go to his favorite Chinese restaurant, Szechuan restaurant, where he knew the owners, and he never went by the menu because he knew the great stuff that wasn't on the menu, which I still, to this day, it's like, what on earth did he order? Because I've never had it since. But he knew just what to order, and we'd bring it back to the house and have long talks. And he would tell me all kinds of things when we would sit down. His life as a young man, his preordained path to be a minister, and how that his decision to take a different path, and how it initially upset his dad, but when he enlisted in the military and sort of made his way in his career, his dad became very proud of his path in the end. And the Chinese language program that he was recruited for, he exhibited exceptional capabilities, which is no surprise, and was plucked to do sort of an immersion language program. You all know this, of course, but I'm going to repeat it because it's also endlessly fascinating to me. And he trained Chinese airline pilots to fly in World War II. So they were our allies. He had to learn Chinese, and he also sort of had to learn how to fly a plane, essentially, and then teach them to fly a plane, which, again, just is extraordinary and just goes to his amazing ability to learn and amass all kinds of knowledges and apply them. He would talk about his years as an economics professor, the research and development work he did, creating policies in Indonesia, as Genevieve said, that were focused on prosperity for that country, and the many stories of being there in Indonesia, the people and the places and the adventures that he had with his family. So it all just was quite amazing to hear what an extraordinary life that he and Kay created for his family. I would also seek his counsel. We spent times where, you know, I have a family of three kids, and I would talk about parenting things, and he was always a great listener and had, you know, gentle ways of providing insights, and as Cindy said, just endlessly patient with what it is to be a parent, and had lots of different advice for me. He was a mentor. I was involved in an international diplomacy project in Chile, and so he had all kinds of encouraging words and thoughts about how I pursue those. As far as being having the privilege to be sort of invited into this family, Kathy, Doug, and Alan, and Cindy too. I appreciate all the efforts you made in keeping me in the loop, especially when Doug's health started to deteriorate. It's been such an honor to be welcomed into your family in this way. It is an exceptional family, and it really has been quite a time to be to witness it. As everyone has said, his family was the center of his universe. He had so much love for his family, so much pride in his boys, his grandchildren, and of course, the delight in his great-grandchildren of Rory and Violet. What a gift that he got to see and hold those little babies. It's impossible to miss seeing his many stellar qualities that are embedded in each of you. His kindness, his generosity of spirit, his intelligence and breadth of knowledge, and his most gentle and beloved benevolent spirit. Alan and I have forged a wonderful friendship because he's sort of the conduit that would give me the heads up. I'd get a text or something to just let me know what's going on or invite me over. They surprised me last year on my birthday, and Doug came with a bouquet of flowers, which was just so very sweet. So I know I don't have to tell you this, but you're just so lucky to have had such an extraordinary man as your dad and your grandfather and your father-in-law. The depth of love that you have for Doug has been so evident every time I visit. He was the centerpiece of the family, which made him so happy. The loving ways that each of you have cared for him so tenderly has been quite something to witness. He was a very lucky man, and I'm a very lucky woman to have known him, to have him as such a dear friend. So rest in peace, Doug.
I'll do my best to get through this. Thank you all for the wonderful words honoring my father, who I think everybody has touched on what a special person he was. And I think the bottom line is he took care of people, and my stories will bring that out, just as all of your stories have. I'm wearing his typical attire today. I don't think I've ever worn a double-breasted shirt like this before, but it's what he wore all the time. And for when folks look at the slideshow and the memorial show, if you haven't seen, you'll notice it. Maybe the first 20 years of his life or 30 years he didn't wear them, but pretty much everything from the mid 70s on, he always had the same kind of shirt on. And this shirt I gave him for Father's Day 5 years ago, and he loved wearing it, and it means a lot to me to be able to wear it. My dad's early life has been touched on. He was born in Hancock, Minnesota on December 13, 1921. And his father was a Christian Reformed minister and very strict dad. My dad told me all about what it was like to be raised by a very strict parent. And my dad, I think it sowed the seeds of the rebellion in him. He was going to do what he wanted, but he always did it tactfully and with love. I mean, he was not one of those rebellious folks that was in your face, but you know, he listened to his dad, but eventually, as mentioned by others, he did not follow in his footsteps and become a minister, which my grandfather wanted him to be. And my dad all went to Calvin College in Minnesota. He got scholarships from many other schools, full scholarships, and his father said, Doug, you've got to go to Calvin. I mean, it's our religion, you're going to go to Calvin College. And you know, he got no scholarship there. He could work and pay his way through there. He gave up full free ride University of Minnesota. He was about the top student in the state and couldn't go there because his dad wouldn't let him. So my dad dutifully went to Calvin and was pre-sem. And he actually, 3 months before graduation, he enrolled in the military for World War II. He had an easy deferment, but he told me two things. He said, you know, I did it for two reasons. One is that I wanted to serve my country, but two, I knew that if I could go in the military, I wouldn't have to go to seminary. I mean, I can delay all that stuff, and I didn't feel good about it. So he went on, and as Jen mentioned, he tested at the top of all the recruits, and so they said, well, we don't want to send you to the front lines. We're going to have you do something else. And so he learned Chinese in 12 weeks, which is pretty amazing. And he went to Harvard. He went to Ohio State for a little while to learn it. That's unfortunate. But my dad actually said it was really nice to him there, and he didn't understand my deep hatred for Ohio State. But he came out and spoke incredible Mandarin, and as Jen mentioned, he translated, but he had to actually know some technical stuff too for them. And he told me one story about a fighter pilot that he always went up with, and they finally said, okay, this person's ready for their own flight. And my dad said, no, do not let him go. But he is cocky, he is not ready. He is not ready, and he fought. As anybody knows my dad, he really felt when there was a principle, he was gonna fight through it. And you know, he went and said, you can't let this guy up. And they said, nope, you who are you? You know, you're just an interpreter. And the gentleman went on his first flight and crashed, and that was that. And you know, it just shows my dad got it. He understood what was going on. He really understood people. He understood when people were ready to take off and do things with their career. He did the same thing with his students over the years. He knew how much guidance they needed and when they were ready to go on their own. And he did the same with his children and his grandchildren. A story that a real quick issue going back on the taking care of people. Early in my dad's marriage to my mom, she had some real problems. She was hospitalized for 2 years, had a lot of psychiatric issues, and was inpatient at Massachusetts General for a couple of years. And it got worse and worse, and eventually she became non-communicative. And my dad stood by her and helped her and did everything he could. Eventually he was told, we don't think she's going to make it. You should go on with your life. Go on and do your career. He went to Indonesia for a while, but tried to keep in touch with her. When he came back, my mom eventually kind of woke up and became part of the family. But my dad was very, very loyal, and he really took care of her. I certainly wouldn't be here if he hadn't. And, you know, my mom was very fortunate with his deep sense of loyalty and love and caring for her. One memory I have from when I was a child that sort of shows my dad in a nutshell was when I was in seventh grade, I really wanted to play baseball. We used to live in Chevy Chase, Maryland, and my brother and I played neighborhood baseball all the time, but there wasn't a little league there. So when we moved to Michigan when I was in seventh grade, I was very sad to leave Maryland, but the one good thing was they actually had Little League, so I could try out for Little League, and I thought I was pretty good. So I go do the tryout, and nobody picked me. I was one of three kids that nobody picked. Nobody wanted this tall, clumsy-looking buffoon on their team. And my dad's reaction, they called each of the kids' fathers and said, you know, we got these three kids nobody wants, and we also don't have a manager. Is anybody interested in taking these three kids and building their own team? And my dad knew nothing about baseball. He didn't know the rules. He had no interest in it. But because it was his son and what his son wanted to do, he said, yes, sign me up. I'll be the coach. I'll be the manager. He knew nothing about baseball. He's like, he had no clue. But what he did know is he knew how to handle a challenge. So he read up everything he could about baseball. He started to watch baseball on TV. And we recruited a team, and it was basically the Bad News Bears. You know, we got the one guy who was kind of a pothead, but he'd been a really good athlete when he was young, and we signed him up, and he ended up dominating. I think he gave up like 5 hits all year as a pitcher, and he was like 10-0. And we ended up going to the championship with this ragtag group of people, which I kind of was the band leader, looking like a ragtag. And we did great, and my dad, but it was my dad who learned something new, just like he learned Chinese, he learned baseball. And his big thing was this sport, this is for the kids to make them all feel good about themselves. So he made sure everybody played the same amount. Winning wasn't more important than everybody playing and everybody learning to like each other and come together as a team and come together as a community. And it really gave me an insight into the person he was. And it really was amazing. And I realized the gift he gave me then, but I realized it even more years later when I realized, I can't imagine like something like soccer that I don't really understand. I can't imagine like when Carly was a kid, being a coach of a soccer team when I don't know anything about it and taking the energy to do that. But yeah, my dad did that. I wanted to make sure there was a funny story in here. Another thing that was really important for my dad and I is we loved to fish together. My dad grew up in Minnesota on the lakes, and that was the one connection with his dad. His very disciplinarian dad, my dad loved fishing like my grandfather did, and that was their connection. And when they were out fishing, they had that dad-son time that was really powerful, and that was the way that my grandfather could share love to my dad. Was he was so proud of his fishing prowess and what he could do with that, and they just had a special time there. So my dad, when he had two children, he wanted to share fishing with them, and my brother Scott was the first to get a chance to go fishing with my dad, and my brother had no interest. They went out, and like after about 5 minutes, you know, this is the way my dad told the story, my brother was like, when are we leaving and when are we gonna eat? You know, what are we gonna, you know, so this is boring. This is like the dumbest thing ever. And then my dad took me out fishing, and I just loved it. I just loved being out on the water. I loved having that time with my dad. And he was a really good fisherman, so we always caught fish. And I thought that was kind of fun and exciting. And I eventually decided I loved it so much, I was going to do that with my life. I was going to study freshwater lakes, and I was going to be a fisheries guy. And I went to college, and I studied all that stuff and did all those classes. And I was going to do that until I did an internship in it, and I found it was horrible. It was cold, it was mud, there weren't people around. It was just like a horrible, horrible life. But you know, then I eventually did something else. But you know, it was that love of fishing that my dad put in. But it was like it was a way to be close to him. But my funny story is, when I was 15, my dad was spending a summer in Toronto, and he invited me to come spend the weekend with him. And he had really close this to a Chinese family, extended Chinese family, and they were going to have this big fishing contest. And he said, Doug, I need you there because you're a good fisherman. We're going to win this contest. We're going to win it, I promise. And I go, good, fine, Dad. So I went, and we go out, and it's this big deal about the rules, and we all have like 3 hours to go fishing. It's going to be based on how many fish you catch, not the weight, but how many you catch. And so my dad and I find a good place to fish, and the first thing that happens is about his third cast, he throws it out into the air, and this large gull comes by and grabs the lure in the midair, gets hooked, and it's flying away. And my dad's like, I'm trying to reel a gull in. And I said, Dad, that's a bad idea, because number one, that's going to get in here and it's going to flap around and cause a disaster. And number two, they're not going to count it because it's not a fish. And so, you know, I cut the line, and so he got, you know, he got going, and he started catching fish, and I started catching fish. We had about 40 fish, and we knew we were going to just blow them away. And so about a half hour before we were going to go in, we're getting ready to pull the stringer with the fish up, and it comes unhooked, and it hits the bottom of the lake. So our 40 fish are on the bottom of the lake. It's about 15 feet down. I can see them. My dad looks at me, and he goes, do you want to jump in for them, or should I? And I looked at him, I said, Dad, I said, you know, I was 15, I'm like, what kind of judgment is that? I mean, I'll jump into the thing, I'm going to get back in the boat, I'm going to flip the boat over, we're going to both be in the water with an overturned boat, that's not a good idea. And he's like, but we want to win that contest. So we hooked up all our lures that we had, and we kind of re-hooked the whole thing and dragged it up from the bottom, got in the boat, got back. And they said we were 2 minutes late, so we didn't win. Yeah. Anyway, but it's a memory. The memory is much better than winning the contest. The whole story, and it just kind of caught my dad's competitive nature. His, you know, he wants to be successful with his son. It has so many things that just tell me about my dad. Another thing that's been touched on that's so important about, you know, my dad taking care of people was his deep love of Indonesia and the people of Indonesia. That became his area of expertise. He was probably the top expert in Indonesian economics in the world. And he did a lot of research there, but his research was not like a lot of people's. He would actually go to the villages, get to know everybody there, live with the people in these remote villages. He would stay on the floor in a house without a with a dirt floor or a cement floor, and he'd just stay with a cover on. There was no hotels in some of these islands that he would go to. There were no bathrooms either. He would tell me about how it was quite the excitement when he would go out to pee and everybody would want to look and see what the guy looked like. And he thrived in that stuff. I mean, you know, that would embarrass the heck out of me, but my dad was like, yeah, it's all good. It's, you know, it's what everybody does. That's how everybody lives. And how can I give advice if I don't know and live with the people and understand what their lives are like? And he made huge changes to the economy of some of these smaller islands that probably saved thousands and thousands of lives and made such a change for them. He never boasted about it. You know, he would tell the fun stories, but I could easily connect the dots and see what an impact he had. And again, he wanted to take care of people. He cared about people who didn't have, and he felt that it was his responsibility to help those in need. And that was a value that was so deep and huge in my father. And he did it in his career. He did it with people that he cared about. Whenever he saw a need, he would be there first. And the thing that I wanted to finish up with is, in the later years, I especially saw that in his care for my mother again. Like early in their marriage, this happened where he was having to take care of her, and for a number of years at the end, he was helping take care of her. Now, he wasn't doing it by himself. You know, Carly lovingly took care of him and my mom so much. Cindy would help. Alan was there with my dad for the later, you know, his last 6 years of his life. He was his constant companion. Kathy would check on my dad too, and it was our whole family that connected with him. But my dad was the one who really was there for my mom, and my mom lived her last 5 years of her life. She got five more years of her life because of Genevieve and because of my dad. You know, the two of them really made a difference and kept my mom alive. So, you know, just to summarize, he was someone who cared about people, and he did it in his way. He didn't boast about it. He didn't talk a lot about it. He just did it. You know, he was a person of action, a person of compassion, a person with intense loyalty and loyalty to his family. You know, I rarely ever saw my dad get angry. He would get angry in later years. Carly got a chance to say to Alan, you know, and all, you know, all of us as we get older get grumpier. It's just kind of an age thing. So for people that are younger, enjoy being calm when you're young. But you know, for so many years, when I was younger, I'd see my dad get angry every two or every 3 years, but every time it was always over the same thing. It was some gross injustice to somebody. It wouldn't have to be in our family, but my goodness, if it was to somebody in the family, watch out. Watch out. And I'll finish with this last story, and when I was 4 years old, I was playing with a neighbor child who was, we were running around in her yard, and our little dog got loose, and so I started to chase the dog, and I guess I crossed a line she didn't like, so she took a hoe that was sitting there, and she sliced my head open. And so, you know, kind of cut my head all the way open, and it's a mess. And so I go home, and I'm kind of a mess. And so I get taken to the hospital and stitched up, and all's good. My dad did not go over to that house and tell the family anything. He didn't say, you need to make your four-year-old kid better behaved. He understood that these are what happened when four-year-old kids get together unsupervised. And he felt, you know, he let his kid go over there unsupervised. It's not that person's fault. And so you could see that compassion and that idea that he's not out there to point fingers. Fast forward 2 years, I'm now six and I'm playing with that same kid. I hadn't learned my lesson. And we were playing croquet in the street. And I took my croquet mallet and went backwards and I bashed out the front headlight of her dad's car. And so there's a broken, you know, headlight there. And so I'm like, oh, I don't want to do it. So I came home, and about 5 minutes later, the dad comes up to the door and says, what is wrong with your child? He broke our headlight. What are you going to do about it? My dad's fuse exploded at that point. He looked at him and goes, well, you really think that it's important about a headlight. When your daughter sliced open my son's head 2 years ago, did you see me at your door? And he kind of retreated a bit and laughed. And I think the other reason, my dad was 6'1", this guy was about 5'6". So once he saw my dad, you know, he got a little scared. My dad would not hurt anyone, though. You know, he has a lot of bluster from time to time, as some of you folks have got a chance to see, but he was absolutely about the gentlest person around. Anyway, I thank all of you for your wonderful stories. It's brought great healing to me. I appreciate so much, Rich, for you listening to us and being flexible with us and helping us try to heal as a family. And I believe we're so lucky to have all those years with my dad. It's a very special time. And you know, it's given us all strength to carry on what was the best of him and do that for the rest of our lives.
We have just heard stories of a very full life. I knew that I would, I only met Doug in his last year, but I knew that I would like him immediately. We bonded, if you will, my first visit over Donald Trump. I don't need to say any more than that. and then how my heart bonded with him and why I knew I was in the presence of an extraordinary person, is he would tell me some of those stories. He told me some of those stories about going to the islands that were still primitive. I mean, just nothing, just, you know, trading fish for a bone kind of thing. And the love that he had for those, for the people, period. I mean, that, I think it was, you all know what these stories reflected. And I realized that this is going to be an interesting guy to get to know. So in hearing these stories today, it's a rich of sharing, of loyalty. I'm reminded of that biblical verse, to whom much is given, much is expected. And Doug had an abundance of gifts. But just because you're given it, doesn't mean that there's going to be any fruit that results. But he took his time and talent and treasure that he had in his life, and he shared those gifts for a greater good. And I think that is one of the spiritual lessons of his life. He wasn't obsessed about himself, wasn't focused on himself. It was always in context of a greater, more common good. I think, personally, that life is like a long, adventurous story. And each of us have a part to play in that story. Some are just a sentence in the story, but if you pull that sentence out of the story, it's incomplete. And some become characters whose paragraph flavors the story with pizzazz and keeps the reader totally focused. I think Doug was an entire chapter in God's book of life. Blessed with long life, Doug modeled his own on the image of God that is found in Psalm 113. Who is like the Lord our God, who raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes? God gives the barren woman a home, making her the joyous mother of children. Doug used his intellect, his personality, his connections, the whole of his life towards the vision of helping lift the poor into new possibilities and to give the barren the joy of greater potential. His gifts of imagination and creativity, of being able to see what others just cannot see, his humility in wanting to be with the people and not just in the academic ideals that I'm sure fired him up and was so much a part of his life, his commitment to personal relationships and mentoring has truly shaped and assisted not only your family, but friends and an entire nation on their quest for a more abundant life. His paragraph in God's Book of Life is bathed with light and goodness, and for that we give thanks. I keep thinking of that old phrase, and now let us praise, a great man. We also see in Doug those themes from Paul's letter to the Philippians, themes of rejoicing and gentleness and peace and a life lived responsibly towards greater purpose. And the sheer energy of the man. I was stunned when I first met him and he told me he had been playing tennis till he's 93 years old. I can barely walk around the block. His insatiable curiosity, his depth of history, his unconquerable love and loyalty to family and lifelong relationships. This isn't just normal. We don't say this, and we don't say this in the depth that you all have witnessed to of everyone. This was a life lived fully. So yes, we are here remembering and honoring a great man. An honorable man, a man who gave of himself, a man who lived before God in the fullness of sacred spirit. We're here to give thanks to God who so loved the world that Doug Paauw lived among us, shared himself honestly with us, lived his spirituality through the integrity of his life, a deep and profound faith that God is present, that light shines in darkness, that mountains can be moved. Scripture asks, death, where is your victory? And we who gather this day affirm that Doug's sacred spirituality that causes us to know that Doug's death after a long, long life is not a capitulation to sorrow unrelenting. Rather, it is a releasing, and it is a footnote. Because Doug lives. He lives in the life of his son, lives in the life of your family, lives in the life of a family of friendships that spans the world, and lives in the lives of those who never even knew him, but who have benefited from the work of his life. And Doug lives also within the forever life of a God he trusted, whose eternal book has a chapter all of its own, written in Doug's honor for greater common good. And so we say, well done, good and faithful friend of God. God gave Doug the gifts. Doug thanked God through living and sharing those gifts. And so in Doug's faith, let us pray a prayer that Doug knew well. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And so may the giver of life give you hope that tomorrow, the world that Doug worked for with all of his might will come in its glory and promise. And may the giver of life give you the faith that your own efforts will result in restoration, reconciliation, and renewal for your family, for your friends, for the earth and its peoples. And may the giver of life give you love, a heart so full of compassion that your personal presence enlightens all who surround you. Death has no victory over the people whose God is the God of life. I bless you in the name of the Creator and the Redeemer and Sustainer.